I think a lot of the support that industry got, they didn't spend it on their people.
Hi, I'm Shoma Chaudhary. Thank you for watching Inquiry. India is in urgent need of a health fix. On the economic front, while the government claims they can see some green shoots and we are approaching pre-COVID levels of economy, there are others who project that India will not just contract by 5%, but in the double digits. On the health front, COVID numbers are spiking, and while governments have done a lot, erratic decision-making at every level is holding back the economy and a return to livelihoods. On the democracy front, over the last couple of weeks, we've seen a symbolic charade as an elected government in Rajasthan and the governor have been at loggerheads over calling assembly, and there have been scurrilous allegations of horse trading. At other levels, we've been seeing the arrests of civil society activists and professors and differential FIRs against those who protested against the CAA and those who took part in the riots. To discuss what shape that health fix can take, I have someone extraordinary at Inquiry today, Kiran Mazumdar-Shaw. Chairman and founder of Biocon, Kiran is India's first self-made woman billionaire. She had wanted to start out life as a bruise master, but that was seen as a male domain. And so, with 10,000 rupees at age 25, in a garage with a retired garage mechanic, she started out Biocon, and she found it hard to hire because people thought that she's a secretary. From there, she's built it to a $7 billion company, and she's today at the forefront of India's health battle against COVID. But what also makes Kiran really special is that she always speaks her mind, and she's been speaking about the economy, about health, and India's democracy. I'm delighted to have you join us, Kiran. This episode of Inquiry was hosted in association with The Quorum, a club in Gurgaon. And I'd like to thank Inquiry's two key partners, the Glenlivet, which really keeps our spirits high, and Indigene, a global healthcare solutions company that looks at the intersections between technology and healthcare.
So, Kiran, to start with, you know, I wanted to ask you about the wonder drug, Itolizumab, which is, like you said, a kind of made in India drug, a novel drug produced in India. And it was seen to be very effective in the cytokine storm that COVID creates. So it was meant to be part of the national protocol for COVID cure. And a few weeks ago, the DGCI gave you permission. So it was really a big thing. And then last week, they seem to have had some doubts and have asked you for more data. So what happened? Can you give us some clarity on that?
So let me start by saying that this is a very unique drug. Actually, it's something, this is a molecule that I licensed almost 20 years ago from a Cuban immunology research center. And I was very intrigued by this molecule because it had a mechanism of action which was very, very unique. It was an immune modulator which was able to, you know, downregulate what we call as cytokines and was able to basically be very efficacious in autoimmune diseases. And I felt this was a great drug to develop in India. And I developed it for psoriasis and rheumatoid arthritis, which are known as autoimmune diseases. And when COVID happened, initially everyone thought it was a very severe pneumonia, ARDS kind of a disease. But it was only in mid-March and later on when Italy and Spain and US started having these huge numbers of deaths because they didn't understand what was happening, that people started realizing that there was a hyperimmune activity taking place, which was almost in my mind akin to an intense autoimmune reaction of the body. And that is what was killing the patients. So I just felt that, hey, the way this cytokine storm is happening in such a huge, furious way is like a very intense autoimmune disease. So can we look at the mechanism of action that itolizumab has to actually get rid of the cytokine storm and the autoimmune disease that it creates? So we decided to basically use this drug, which was already approved in India, which had undergone phase 2, phase 3 trials and had been in the market for 7 years. So, you know, the safety data was very well known of this drug. So we actually went to the regulators, the DCGI, and asked them whether we could do this small trial as a repurposed drug. All 20 patients who were on the drug arm recovered, and 3 of the patients who were on the non-drug arm died.
Was that too small a sample?
Yeah, so what I was saying was, yes, it was a very small data set. So I think the reason why the National COVID Task Force decided not to basically include it in their national treatment protocol is they wanted more data. I think the kind of data that we are now generating in the real world, what we call real world evidence, is very, very compelling, because now we've had the emergency use authorization for just over 2 weeks, and we've actually, you know, used it in over a few thousand patients. So you can understand why prescribers are very excited about this drug and how patients are benefiting from this drug.
There's little that we know, the good times come and go, but the best is yet to come.
So, you know, Kiran, I hope that the scale of, like you said, the scale of data expands, because I know that you've personally, and you've been in the business for decades, and you've been very, very excited by the outcome of this drug. And it's interesting that, you know, while this was a kind of curative drug, on the other hand, we have the Serum Institute, you know, the Poonawallas, who are part of the Oxford trial, and it may turn out that that's the vaccine that first makes the finishing line, in which case, with your drug and the vaccine, India would really be leading the health fight against COVID, you know, by around December. So, of course, one hopes your drug gets passed at a national protocol level. But now, just coming to the issue of vaccines, Kiran, you know, it's been making headlines, the Oxford trial. Serum Institute says that they're really risking it and they're going to go ahead and manufacture 200, 300 million vials even before the absolute clearances come. What is your assessment of the months ahead? When do you think the vaccine is possible, the large-scale manufacturing of it, and what would be the vaccine protocol? So using this moment, if you were to put out a really strong message about COVID right now, and how we are responding to it, what would it be?
So, you know, I think, Shoma, people should understand that vaccine development is quite a complex and long process, because, you know, a vaccine needs to, A, be efficacious. That means it needs to get an immune response. It needs to be safe when it's giving you that immune response, and it needs to endure. So it needs to protect you for a certain period of time. Right now, all the vaccines are in what they call as a warp speed accelerated process, because the whole world is anxious and waiting for the vaccine to keep it safe. And in the process, unfortunately, you might be taking a lot of shortcuts and you might be overlooking certain safety and risk assessments that you normally do with a normal vaccine development. Now, these are not normal times, so I guess you do have to take certain risks. But you have to also make sure that you take measured risks and you understand the risk-benefit ratio. So, in fact, I just let out a tweet just now saying, if you do get a vaccine first, who should get that vaccine? I don't think anyone expects the vaccine to arrive before the early next year. But I think the more important thing is to say, even if the vaccine arrives in January, who should you safely vaccinate? I mean, everybody wants the vaccine and they say, oh, you must give it to the most vulnerable, you must give it to the elderly, you must give it to... No, you can't do that. The people whom you can possibly risk at that stage are the young, are the youth, okay? And you can possibly risk at least the health workers, because if you hope that it's protecting the frontline health workers, because they do need protection. But even there, you have to make sure that you don't give it to the elderly healthcare doctors and professionals. So I think people don't realize that safety is so important in vaccines, that until you get some safety established of vaccines, you should not be even exposing the elderly or the ones with comorbidities, or even children for that matter.
With all these variables at play, it's really like such an uncertain landscape. And that's why my second part of the question was understanding the landscape for what it is. Having seen the disease now from actually in effect January to, so it's 6 months of the disease, thankfully, a lot of the really apocalyptic predictions have not come true. So if you today, with all the hindsight as well as the awareness you have now, wanted to put out one message about what, let's just take India, not speak for the world, India's response to COVID now should be in terms of getting back to work or seeking protection, staying safe, reviving economy. What's the one clear message that you would like to put out?
So the one clear message I'd like to put out is that, look, we have to start resuming our lives. You know, you cannot stay locked up for any longer. But at the same time, we know that the infection rates are very high. So I really believe that we do need to be very cautious about the way we mandate mask wearing, the way we ban gatherings. I mean, that is still not happening. You know, I keep getting invited to inaugurations and foundation laying ceremonies. And I'm telling these people, why are you doing that? You should not have so many people congregating at one place. That's not at all acceptable. Secondly, I think you must ensure that your workplaces are safe by testing. I think testing is going to be very important. And keeping a vigil on outbreaks is very important in terms of containment and quarantining. And most of all, I think what is good, what the good things that are happening is that I think our medical care is improving. We are understanding the disease better. We've got many more things to fight COVID with. So I think the death rate is something that you have to watch very carefully. So to me, the way I've gone about telling governments, please keep testing more and please keep your eye on test positivity rates. If you start seeing your test positivity rates coming down with larger testing, that's a good sign. If you see mortality rates declining, that's a very good sign.
Kiran, you know, in fact, when I was speaking about the kind of mixed messaging that's come around, and it's not to blame anyone, it is a very difficult situation, but there's also been this kind of white hot focus just on this disease to the exclusion of all else, you know, and there are many doctors, the UN itself has been trying to draw attention that we've almost become blinded by this now. And the fact is that the mortality rate is not as frightening as one had imagined. And, you know, this obsession with how many people are going to fall ill, how many are getting infected, would one be correct to say that, you know, even if, like, for instance, let's take Ramanan Lakshminarayanan, he had said by July, 300, 400 million people could be affected. Because our testing rates are low, the fact is that actually 40 million could be affected today or 300 million could be affected. We don't really know. But the point is that the finite end is the death rate and the hospitalization rate, needing acute hospitalization. That's a finite number. Thankfully, in India, it has not been exploding. So I want to ask you the issue of fear. There's all the protocols. Everyone knows everything about COVID that is possible to know now. There's the issue of fear. Do you think that the fear quotient around this disease now needs to actively go down, or should it be sustained so that safety is maintained?
Look, Shoma, the fear factor emanates from the fact that you've got a huge number of people infected in the world and a large number infected in India. So you've crossed 12 million people across the world who are infected with COVID-19. And in fact, it's closer to 15 million now. You know, people often say, a million people die of cancer every year, a million people die of this every year, and this is nothing. But that's not true, because this is happening in such a short time that it is very scary. Okay. you don't think about all these other diseases because it happens across the year. And for a country like the US, which is still not in control of the pandemic, or many parts of the world are not in control of the pandemic, and you're seeing second waves and you're seeing second surges of infection, it is going to cause a lot of worry. So unless you have a very, very proven track record of managing the disease, and therefore your death rates have to come down below 1%. Today, I'm sorry, we are not at that level. Even India, we are at 3% and, close to 3%.
So the short on that, Kiran, there is a kind of mixed messaging. You know, at one level, governments and, industry captains, economists are now saying, get back to work. We need to save livelihoods. At another level, we say the fear is justified. We start something, 2 days later, there are lockdowns, there are alternate day lockdowns. But your short answer is no, the fear is justified and we'll probably carry on in this chop and change way for some time longer.
Am I right? So let me answer your question in many ways. One is, was the lockdown necessary? Yes, I think the lockdown was very necessary to get us into a state of preparedness. Then what happened is, when you lifted the lockdown, the general message that the people got is, oh, the virus has gone away and now the coast is clear and we can get back to normal life. But that was not the right message, because I think people should have understood that, by the way, you have to be even more careful now that we have lifted the lockdown, because this virus has gone nowhere. It's actually lurking around. I would say you do need clear messaging, and they have to keep repeating and reiterating that messaging that we are not yet safe. That, if we do need to get back to our livelihoods, but we cannot do it in a business as usual fashion.
So, Kiran, I'm going to come back to the whole area of COVID. I just wanted to move a little bit to a larger framework, which is that this global focus, and in India, perhaps for the first time, such intense focus on health is actually also an opportunity to redress, to reprioritize a lot of things. Interestingly, you've said that the health sector could be the next IT sector, that there's so much potential here. So both in the traditional sense of human resource, as well as in terms of digital solutions and AI and, technological solutions to health, why do you think that this is such a sunrise sector which we should be addressing? Globally, it's like an $11 trillion industry. We are a very small participant in that. So could you spell out what you see, both in the human resource as well as the technology end?
Yeah, so I think we have some natural, strengths in the whole healthcare sector. It is a $100 billion sector already in India. Because if you look at the pharmaceutical sector, it is a $50 billion sector. And the rest comes from, of course, the hospital sector, which is a pretty growing sector. Now, if you ask me, look, we are the world's vaccine producer. We are the world's generics producer. I'm trying to become the biologics producer of the world. So from a pharmaceutical and biopharmaceutical point of view, we are very, very dominant in terms of volume. Now we need to add value. And that's where I feel that we must innovate and get into research-led innovation, development, and manufacturing. Now you come to the rest of the healthcare sector, which is all about the medical device sector. I think this particular pandemic has actually unleashed a huge potential in diagnostics, in medical devices, in digital healthcare, and so on and so forth. Today, India is already becoming very good at AI-based, reading of CT scans to know whether this patient has a certain level of COVID or not. These are the kind of things that are being done in terms of diagnostics. And then you've got the world has started focusing on healthcare. And they realize that everyone's healthcare system is broken. Including India, we've realized our weaknesses. We know that we have it. We have most of it there. We've got primary, secondary and tertiary healthcare networks, but they are broken and they are very underinvested in. And we know today from our government hospitals how much we needed to invest to make them at least cope with COVID. And you can see the number of COVID care centers that were set up because our systems just couldn't carry the weight of the disease. Now, I think we are in a very privileged position in the sense we create 50,000 doctors every year. We create hundreds of thousands of nurses every year. Now, one of the things this year, in fact, Dr. Devi Shetty came up with a brilliant idea. One of our biggest challenges in the COVID crisis, as Dr. Devi Shetty very rightly said, beds don't treat patients. It's the nurses and doctors who do that. And we don't have enough of them to treat the number of patients who are landing up in these centers. What he suggested was that we've got almost 100,000 nurses waiting to graduate. And they're all sitting at home and we insist that they should go through a written exam. He says, this is an unusual time. Why can't we just tell these 100,000 nurses that they are all automatically graduating on the condition that they all come and serve in the COVID hospitals for a certain period of time, at the end of which they will automatically get their nursing degrees. I think that's a brilliant way of expanding the healthcare resource in the country that we are so short of. So I think we need to think out of the box. And I think that healthcare is a sector. We can make this into a $500 billion sector in no time. Because I really believe that we have everything that it takes. We have scientists, we have chemical engineers, we have biotech, we have, of course, doctors and healthcare professionals and medical technologists. You name it, we have them in large numbers. We have to leverage this because I think healthcare diplomacy for India can be huge across the world.
You know, earlier in the inquiry show, I'd spoken to Dr. Ian Lipkin of Columbia University, and he pointed out that there's this huge opportunity, especially for manpower-intense countries like India, to actually raise what he called a health army.
And, you know, our ASHA workers themselves are amazing. You just need to basically upgrade their skills.
Right. And you were talking about exporting healthcare workers to other countries. So just the words we use so that people begin to see it actually as an area of potential. Because if you talk of it as export, then people might begin to think of it differently, you know, give it an industry status. And I just wanted to share a statistic, you know, to emphasize what you're saying, that you're speaking that we have thousands of doctors and nurses, but actually we have 2 million nurses missing in the system. We have one doctor for every 10,000 people.
Yeah, our statistics are not so great.
Yeah, no, which only shows that our own domestic market is not yet saturated, you know. And
That's true. But it's a bit of a chicken and egg situation because people go after employment opportunities. And if the opportunities are global, you'll get many more people coming into that particular sector. But we also have to free up the sector. We are too over-regulated as a sector. You know, the MCI has been strangling this whole medical education sector far too much. You need to unleash it. Because why are we only graduating 50,000 doctors a year? Why are we only graduating 100,000 nurses a year? You can almost... Using now technology and the digital technologies and online education and whatever else you can, I think you can actually multiply this many, many times over.
It's interesting that across the world, actually, the two real triumphs have been Dharavi, which everyone thought would be the explosion point for COVID. And there's now talk that maybe herd immunity has kicked in Dharavi, because health workers, frontline workers have worked so heroically in that high intensity.
But it didn't happen by design. It just happened because there was nothing else you could do. You know, let's face it. Many of these very congested slums, how do you deal with it? So it almost created a herd immunity without design, but, you know, it happened because there was nothing else you could do. But equally, I think you must look at...
That's just an interesting intervention, that there was a medical officer, in fact, who said that if anyone in India now really wants to be safe from COVID, they should go and live in Dharavi.
Yeah.
Because that's the safest place. You know. So that's a big piece of irony for everyone. That was the most congested, most humanly connected, did not have the options to do anything else, and it prevailed, you know. So
that's exactly what I said. But I think this is the fate of most of our country, because if you look at the congestion and the density of populations that we have in most parts of our country, probably that's what is saving them. It's the herd immunity. And it's all of us who live in our own homes and who are vulnerable and don't have the same exposure that, you know, these slum dwellers have. We are the ones who are most vulnerable.
Kiran, the journalist in me is dying to point out that this is really a contradiction, because while we're talking about social distancing, the one area that has actually survived and triumphed is where social distancing wasn't possible. Maybe there's something about just getting back to work, putting on one's masks and carrying on with life. So, Kiran, before we come to economy, I wanted to ask you, has COVID impacted your thinking in any way? Has there been anything that your worldview has changed, your priorities have changed? Personally speaking, how has it impacted you?
I think on many levels, you know, my world, I mean, my thinking, my approach to life, a lot of things have changed a lot. On one side, I think we've all been thrown into the deep end of digital technology, which is a good thing that has happened. We wouldn't be having this kind of a conversation in the real world, because it's always so difficult to find time and get to a physical venue. On the other side, I'm also realizing that, hey, you know, suddenly the environment has cleaned up. I've never seen so many birds flocking in my garden. I've never seen so much lush vegetation around me. So I think it's made me realize that, you know, we ought to really think about doing less of what we are doing in every way possible. I've also realized the materialistic world that we live in, do we really need to be this materialistic? You know, we've already done away with trying to buy our clothes every month. You know, we are sort of managing with whatever we have, right? So I think we've learned to recycle, reuse, not be overly kind of, you know, that consumerism has gone from us. So I think it is getting us back to the old times where we used to be very sparing about the way we went about spending money and spending things on ourselves. And I'm wondering, maybe that's a good thing. So I'm looking at life very differently. Of course, in terms of my philanthropy, of course, it hasn't changed because I've always been philanthropic. But now I realize that the poor are very, very vulnerable. I've realized, you know, when I look at all these people, poor patients who are dying or who can't even afford drugs and who can't even basically even, you know, we've given so many of these food kits and things like that. And I'm saying, it's pathetic. How can we be in a country where we have to feed our millions of people just because they've lost their livelihood, right? I mean, it's actually made me realize what an inequitable world we live in. So it has again made me realize that, yes, my whole ethos of compassionate capitalism, of making sure that we give affordable access to those who can't afford many things, is very important, and it's almost reinforcing my beliefs.
You know, Kiran, it's quite humbling that you're saying this, because within this itself, I think there are massive intellectual challenges that face all leaders. I did speak to two former finance ministers, Mr. Chidambaram and Yashwant Sinha, and both of them said that COVID had humbled them because they realized that even as finance ministers, they had been blind to almost 70-80% of India. You know, we are looking at an informal sector, as you said, that's so fragile that within 2-3 weeks of a lockdown, you know, we saw the biggest human exodus, a kind of compacted migration of human beings that perhaps outrivaled even partition, you know, and we really saw India's fragility in terms of the economy. So when you're saying this, at a individual level, a lot of people are wanting to push back on consumerism, you know, the kind of material overdriven life that one was leading. We need to look at climate change. All of that's going to have an impact on the economy. Retail sectors in trouble, you know, so many sectors are in trouble, the hospitality sectors in trouble. All of that is manpower intensive. So,
And there are two ways of looking at it, because on one hand, you're creating jobs, and on the other hand, you don't want to consume. So, you know, that it's at cross purposes in that way. But I think, I mean, but I'm just saying, you know, at this point in time, it reminds you that you can afford to do a lot and many people can't. And that's what it reminds you of. And I think that inequity, that economic inequity is very, very disturbing. And in fact, I read a very interesting article by Ruchir Sharma the other day, who talked about the failure of capitalism. Because even during this time when governments are trying to bail out businesses, they are bailing out the bigger businesses instead of the smaller businesses. And he felt that it's again that syndrome of too big to fail. We should not be bailing them out because they ought to be resilient. They ought to go through a bad time and come out of it stronger. And yet we are just mollycoddling them. And it's the smaller guys who really need to survive. And we need to actually look after them. And that's the way, because he said, otherwise what you're doing is you're constantly creating that inequity between that small 10% and the 90%. And what are you doing differently even at a crisis like this, right? So after the crisis, you're again going to get it as 95 and 5%. So that's not good. So what he says is, capitalism is about going through these kind of crises and, you know, rebooting yourself and becoming resilient to get over this. And the bigger you are, you ought to be able to do it. You should not want help.
Right. I think that's particularly for the audience that's listening right now and digitally as well. A lot of influencers watch this. Like I said, it's a kind of crossroad for a lot of macro rethinking as well as at a micro level. And so this brings me...
If I may say so, even the kind of huge funding that the big pharma is asking for, I don't think they should be doing that. I mean, basically, they've got enough money to spend on all these things. It's the smaller guys who need it. You know? So that's again what I feel is happening in the world, that BARDA is giving billions to the big companies. I can imagine them giving billions to smaller companies. I think Moderna definitely deserves it. But do you really think companies like, you know, the big pharma who are developing vaccines, do they really need that kind of funding? Don't they have adequate funding to take those risks? Or do they always want the government to take those risks?
That's a great entry point into the whole arena of economy, Kiran. You've earlier in the short term spoken of the disappointment that you felt when the government in India announced its relief and stimuli package. You know, the big picture was that it's a 20 lakh crore relief package, but it fell short for many, many people in terms of its practice and its expectation as well, you know. So now we are 3-4 months beyond the announcement of the package. What do you think has gone right, and what do you think the government seriously needs to do? Just 1 week ago, the finance minister, Nirmala Sitharaman, said that the government feels that, and she feels that, enough green shoots are coming up. There are other ministers who've said that we are looking at a pre-COVID economy level has been reached. Do you feel that these are fair assessments, and what do you think has gone right, and what do you think very urgently needs to be done in the economy?
So I think, the way that they're looking at green shoots is the same thing that I referred to earlier on. I think a lot of the big and medium industry has been supported in some way, you know, like they have brought in measures like deferred GST. But now, you know, the government itself doesn't have GST to give to the state governments for their share of the GST. So there are going to be huge issues. I know that many, many businesses have not got the capital they need to actually, you know, operate. So again, I feel a lot of the small startups, the smaller companies have suffered. I don't think the smaller guys have really benefited from it. I think, yes, some of the mid-sized and large companies are doing quite well. I mean, you know, we've never had, and many sectors are doing well. But I think what you see happening is the airlines industry laying off thousands of people, right? The hospitality, retail, there are thousands of people who have lost their jobs and they don't know what other job they can get. I can tell you, I keep getting applications from people from all these sectors who are saying, just give us a job. We don't mind doing anything. So that's not a good sign. So, you know, I really think that the government ought to have given a furlough for these kind of employees who would have lost their jobs.
I'm sorry, Kiran. I'm sorry. There seems to be a disruption. Could you just We lost the last sentence you said.
I said that I really think that these people who are being laid off and, you know, in huge numbers, these are the people we need to support. Because the sectors that were really most impacted, those were the ones we needed to really focus on and say, okay, how are we going to look after our airlines industries? How are we going to look after our retail industry? How are we going to look after our real estate workers, the construction workers? How are we going to do that? And, you know, that is where I think a lot of the emphasis should have been, of giving them some kind of, you know, daily, some support. Because I think a lot of the support that industry got, they didn't spend it on their people.
In fact, Kiran, I'll ask you two specific things, which is that it's happened in America. And of course, even there, it's a bone of contention. But for people who've lost their jobs, you know, at a white collar level and then on the ground, migrant workers, you know, there's just a huge swath of people who've lost their livelihoods. You've advocated both for a labor fund as well as a wage protection program. The government does not seem to have rolled that out at all. Has there been...
Well, it's financially very challenging for any government to do that for such a huge number of people. So I think the government would love to do it, but I don't think they have the financial wherewithal to do that. But having said that, I still feel that we ought to have a labor fund, you know, and we ought to have some kind of social security for the people who are in the workforce in some way. We can't just leave them to fend for themselves, which is what has happened today.
So has there been a consultative process, you know, with, you know, you're one of the most prominent corporate people in the country. Has government been reaching out, asking for advice, asking for inputs? Have you been?
Well, I haven't really been contacted, but maybe others are, you know.
Well, that's interesting, given that you're very prominent in the health sector.
I normally get involved in the health sector and in biotech and science and technology. I think there are many others who get contacted for these other kind of financial and labor issues, I guess.
Kiran, as being someone who started from a 10,000 rupee garage where you tried to hire a lot of people and you were 25 years old, you said there was such a gender bias that everyone walking in thought that you were a secretary and, you know, did not want to join you. From that to have built a $3 billion company, you know something about...
$7 billion.
Sorry?
$7 billion.
$7 billion. Okay, I stand corrected. So you know something about both creating demand as well as meeting demand. The other interesting thing you said is that India desperately needs to boost demand. You know, it's not about creating liquidity. The financial markets have liquidity. It's about creating demand. If today you were called in to advise the government, what are the first three or four steps that you would suggest to trigger demand in a setting as challenging as this?
Well, there are many ways of incentivizing people to spend. Like, you know, if you give some a tax rebate on spending in certain areas, you know, obviously people would not mind spending. Like, for instance, we know that the automobile sector is very badly challenged. And if you were to basically look at the auto sector and say, okay, we will give you some tax rebates or tax deductions on certain spends, you know, I think that could encourage people to do that. So I think you need to look at sectors which are really badly affected by COVID and seeing whether you can direct spending to those sectors. You know, that's the way you'll have to do it. Instead of giving just an income tax reduction, I think you have to link it to spending, you know.
Right. Kiran, I didn't realize we've kind of spent some time on this and I haven't even spoken about democracy and we want to take questions as well. You tweeted once saying that by critiquing the government's economic policies, you're neither anti-national nor anti-government. Why would someone as prominent as you feel the need to say this? Are you feeling there's a change in environment where to speak out, to critique, to criticize has become more difficult than before? Is there a comparative difficulty or is it singular to this time?
No, I think social media has basically created a huge troll army. And whenever you speak your mind or say something, you feel that you're being attacked. You know, people just go for you. And, you know, you're called all kinds of names. So you can't even talk about, say, for instance, today, if I, like you said, you know, you shouldn't use hubris at this time. You shouldn't, you should be realistic. You should be honest. You have to admit certain faults or flaws or whatever it is. So the moment you do that, you're called anti-national, which I think is stupid. In fact, I'm the biggest patriot. I want to put India on the map of the world for science and technology and research and innovation. Now, if I say that the research and innovation ecosystem is very poor in India, I'm called anti-national. But the fact is we need to strengthen it. We need to improve it. And if we keep believing that everything is fine and everything is wonderful and we have the best innovation ecosystem in the world, we're kidding ourselves. So I think that's where the quandary is, the dilemma is to say, should I talk about it or not? Because every time I speak about it, I'm attacked. But and I'm doing it in the best interests of the country.
Right. What about, you know, Rahul Bajaj, of course, Rajiv Bajaj gave an interview as well, both to Rahul Gandhi and to Barkha earlier, where he also said that it's difficult for people to speak up. You know, the corporate fraternity don't feel comfortable speaking up and yet are occupying such nodal positions of power and impact and influence. So generically, do you feel that there's one about the social media? Do you feel that there's a receptivity in government to criticism? Or would you, again, using this platform, this interview, want to put out a message, you know, about the kind of democratic atmosphere in the country?
No, I think the democratic atmosphere is there. I mean, I don't think there's no, democracy is alive and kicking, I would say, in this world and in India. I don't think I feel that it's not democratic. I just think it's people at large. I think I don't blame the government per se. I blame the media. I blame the people at large. They are the ones who are destroying democracy by taking sides. You should not be taking sides. Today, when you look at any media channel, a media channel's job is to have a debate and a discussion and leave the audience to decide what they think. But here, the anchor themselves decide what is right and what's wrong. And that's what destroys democracy, right? And a good democratic discussion. So that's where the problem is. I blame them. I blame the media. I blame the people. I blame societies for not having this open, discussion or open environment, which we always have. I mean, I know I can still go and talk. Look, let me tell you, I am in a BJP-ruled state, which is fantastically liberal. Okay, every single minister, every single person whom I know is extremely forthright, open, willing to take criticism, willing to get into a discussion. So it's got nothing to do with the party. You can go to a Congress state. Look what's happened in Rajasthan. What's happening there? I mean, you can't blame it on one party or another. I think every party is trying to be very controlling of its own people. But that doesn't mean you have to, you know, the people at large need to feel controlled. They are not controlling the people at large. But it's people who are actually getting into that kind of state. So I don't want to really blame anybody. I think it's ourselves to blame. I'm not scared to speak up because I do it.
That's a great note to end on. Thank you very, very much, Kiran. I'm going to open this up. I could have gone on for another hour. It's wonderful to hear someone speak out their mind, with all its complexities. But I'm going to open this up to the audience. And before that, I'd like to invite Marut Setia, who's the Senior Vice President at Indigene. And as I mentioned, they're a global healthcare solutions. They look at digital solutions for healthcare. And Marut, you wanted to pose a question to Kiran.
Sure. So Kiran, I loved your thought process on why clinical trials need to take as long as they do. But if you start thinking about digital, and you spoke a lot about it, do you think digital interventions like, for example, digital CRO or reaching out to the healthcare professional digitally, would that help in making these trials faster? And how about using these in your own biocon?
No, I think digital technologies are certainly the way of shortening many, many regulatory processes. Don't get me wrong. You know, one of the things that digital technologies and, you know, these kind of digital platforms allow you to do is to do a lot of parallel processing. So you can very sharply bring down the times. I think I fully subscribe to shortening the times. But there are some things which you can't shorten. For instance, you know, no matter how much predictive algorithms and biologies you can come up with, you still cannot extrapolate certain kinds of biological data to predict that this is how much it will protect you for. You know, those kind of algorithms are yet to develop. So you do need to validate those kind of prediction models in time. So I'm saying this is a time when you're trying to develop a vaccine for a very difficult virus. And the question mark is that if you were to get a vaccine in the next 2 months, would you be really would you really think it's safe enough is the question. So I think you need to validate it digitally all the time and keep doing post-hoc analysis and do predictive analysis to say, okay, based on this, I think it will protect you for X number of months and see whether it works out. And if it works out, you can use it for the next vaccine.
Right. So, no, absolutely. I think there are a lot of analysis that is happening on how you can narrow down the trial using digital analytics to a point where the chances of success are much higher. So.
Yeah, of course you can do it. You have to know what you're measuring. And today it's not just an immune response is what I'm saying. There are many things beyond an immune response.
Absolutely. Makes sense.
See whether that immune response is a hyper response. If so, then is it doing something else? You know, this is what we learned about the virus, right?
Right.
You know, Marut, in fact, Kiran, you were really focusing on the digital end of it. You know, when I asked you how can health sector become the new IT sector in India, Marut, you guys have been involved in this a lot. Just very quickly, if you're looking at the digital shift post-COVID, what has COVID shown us? Does India have the building blocks in place or is there a huge gap? You know, are we very inadequate to make that digital shift?
Yeah. So India is in a very unique situation, if you ask me. I mean, the intent is very, very high, but the digital maturity is a little low. And it is not for lack of trying. I think it takes a lot when you're thinking about implementing a digital thread in the healthcare industry. You really have to have that combination of clinical expertise and the right technology, which finding in-house in an organization, in a pharma organization, is relatively tough. So by last 4 or 5 years, we are seeing some sense of urgency in terms of implementing a digital thread. The focus area still has been more on efficiencies. How can I reduce cost? But with this COVID, I really feel that people have started completely rethinking on how the business model needs to change. So this high touch model of a pharma rep going to a doctor or a medical device consultant going into a hospital, all those being are fundamentally challenged. And that is where I feel organizations are taking a much more holistic view of how do you use data, how do you integrate with the digital thread and use that power of analytics to make smarter decisions. And I guess this is where I think a company like Indigene comes in with 2 decades of experience and having implemented these digital transformations across mature markets and emerging markets, I think with 50 patents, significant investment in AI and machine learning, those are the ingredients that we are missing today in India, which will lead to a successful transformation. I just hope that COVID accelerates it much faster.
Well, you know, Marut, we've just recently announced a partnership with a company called Voluntis, yep, with whom we've developed a digital therapeutics for insulin. They were an FDA-approved product, a digital therapeutic product. And we believe that these are the kind of things that are going to happen in the future. And you're right. I mean, it's not just about it. Everyone talks about digital automation for efficiency, but it should be more from a precision and prediction modeling, which we really need to look at. And we need to sort of basically become more efficient through prediction modeling and rather than just looking at doing things in a very, I always tell people, see, digitization is not just about transferring your knowledge from books to the computer. That's not digitization. Digitization is about how do you basically have a step up in what you're doing, because now you can do things digitally which you couldn't do in the physical world.
Love it. And Kiran, I mean, just picking on that thread, as you know, and especially organizations like yours, which are new innovative drugs, as they move more towards precision medicine, personalization, personalized medicine, this whole idea of using the data and the data analytics power to create a very targeted approach or very targeted therapy, I think those ideas are really catching up.
Well, today, let me be very honest. I mean, all the research we do is very targeted. I mean, today you have to understand pathways and mechanism of action in a very deep way. I mean, that's why I was talking about itolizumab, because we know the mechanism of action. It is very targeted therapy. It is not about just sort of, looking at a possible way of working. You know exactly what it's doing. But, you know, biology is also very complex. So you will have off-target effects, which you must prevent. So that's where I think your analytics comes in. How do you prevent off-target effects? And that's what you need to do for vaccines as well.
Yeah, no, absolutely. In fact, and my last comment, Shoma, I know you are raring to stop me, but I think we have worked with a lot of pharma companies and maybe implement called Intelligent Action Brain, which is where you get data from across the board, different processes that you have, and then organizations are creating a digital strategy office just to analyze that data and improve the efficacy of your product, not just in terms of the way you develop it, but the way you market it, the way you reach the patient, and all the way to how you manage and track adherence. At the end of the day, all of this has to come together to make a successful patient impact. And unless that is done, so I mean, listen, we would love to talk to you more about it. So I'm sure we'll get a chance to do that. Thanks a lot for your time.
It's fascinating.